Now, you were at the meeting with House leaders and stakeholders, the Department of Energy, and also oil companies. I just like to read the quote of Speaker Martin Romualdez to the oil companies. He said, if you are part of the solution, Congress will be appreciative, but if you are part of the problem, we might have to undertake measures that would be unpalatable to you. Congressman, did the speaker just threaten the private sector?
Well, it's not actually a threat, Ms. Karen, but he's just talking about reality. Because earlier during that meeting, he was saying the reason why we're all here because we want to get your ideas or suggestions, how you can help the government, how you can help the people, because the government is also willing to sacrifice. And their suggestion was their first suggestion was if we can take away this or suspend the excise tax. And then another one suggested, another oil player, if we could suspend this bioethanol act, usage of bioethanol act or purchasing it overseas because it's cheaper than buying it here in the Philippines. But then the speaker said okay, so you're demanding this. What can we expect from you? What can the people expect from you as responsible corporations of this country? And then they were so quiet, they were so silent. And so the speaker was saying, come on, if you do not want to help us, then if you do not want to be part of the solution, then you're part of the problem. So we have to do something about it. One of the suggestions Ms. Karen was brought up was a review of the oil deregulation law if they will not cooperate. But towards the end, the representatives of the different oil companies yesterday promised that they will inform the principals or the chairman of the board or their board because they were only middle managers, so they do not have the authority to make decisions at that very point, Ms. Karen.
Okay. When the speaker said unpalatable measures, would the unpalatable measures include, for example, a price cap on oil? Because the president has done it with rice. Is that on the table that the president or the speaker may suggest that the president order a price cap on gasoline and diesel?
We have yet to study that, Ms. Karen, pero I believe it's out of the picture because there is a law right now, the oil deregulation law, wherein the government cannot just simply interfere or modify or do something about the prices because of this oil deregulation law. Not unless we ibasura natin itong oil deregulation law, but for now, I don't see it. It is possible that the government can do it. But except this is desperate measures, according to the speaker, so desperate times, so the president can exercise some powers or Congress and the Senate can give him powers to do such things, so Ms. Karen.
Okay, so how would the speaker describe the situation we're in now when it comes to the price of fuel? Are we in a crisis situation?
Yeah, definitely, Ms. Karen, because yesterday it was brought up and we learned that of the top 10 countries importing here in Southeast Asia, we're on the number 4. We're fourth highest compared to Vietnam. Vietnam is on the 9th position or 10th, and we're on the 4th. So medyo mataas yung presyo natin. This is what the speaker said. And we were asking them, Congressman Kimbo was also asking, how come, if the world market announces there's a price increase today, the following day, we can really feel it because you will make announcement 24 hours later that there's a price increase. When in fact, you're still using on your gas stations the oil supply, old supply. So why is it na pag tumaas sila kahapon, tataas na tayo ngayon? So yung sinasabing logic, Ms. Karen, parang it's not fair because they're still using the old supply. Hindi yung bago. So, dapat hindi apektado yung mga nasa pump sa gasoline stations ngayon. Yun ang sinasabi ni Mr. Speaker. Eh, hindi nila masagot yun, Ms. Karen. So, all they were saying is that they will talk to their principal. So, there's a second round, actually, of this meeting, hopefully by next week.
Okay, now because we don't have a lot of oil players, the big oil players can be actually, let's put it to Petron, Caltex, Shell, and then you have other players, Sea Oil, Clean Fuel, et cetera. But at the end of the day, the market isn't so big to actually compete with each other because there are only a few oil players. Is it possible? Are you sensing a cartel or an unsaid agreement when it comes to oil price increases?
Definitely, Ms. Karen. It was brought up yesterday. Even the speaker agrees that there is a cartel. I mean, they're talking to each other. Kaya nga, somebody suggested, Congressman Marcoleta was suggesting, eh kung ganito, they will not cooperate with the speaker and there's really cartel, then we can review this oil deregulation law, amend this oil deregulation law or do something about it. Kasi nga, if you notice, Ms. Karen, when the world market announces that there's an increase, pare-pareho eh. Nakapagtataka na all of them, the big three corporations, pare-pareho to 20, to the dot, to the point, sabi nga ni Congresswoman Quimbo. Bakit ganon? To the point, hanggang like to the last centavo, pare-pareho kayo. To 24, to 34. Pero if you look at the small players, parang mas mura sila ng 50 cents or 1 peso. Mas mura yung mga small players, Ms. Karen. So we really believe that there is a cartel, hindi lang sa bigas, pati dito sa oil, merong may cartel, Ms. Karen.
Okay, so let's talk about what the government can afford and the calculation of what private companies can actually decrease, right? So the speaker is asking, make a sacrifice as well. In other words, don't profit off this too much. Bawasan nyo ang kita nyo until the end of the year. Parang ganun yun eh, no? Ang sinabi po niya, right? So if it's the excise tax, you gave a calculation that
Right.
prices of gasoline would go down 10% per liter. And for diesel, sabi ng DOE, 15 pesos pala per liter if excise tax is removed. But the government would lose something more than 10 billion by the end of the year. Is that something this administration can afford?
That's the reason why, Ms. Karen, we can only recommend to the president about itong mga napag-usapan yesterday and nasa approval niya yon because our computations with the help of our Congressman Dan Fernando, he was saying, or Dan Fernandez, he was saying like 4.9 billion if we remove the excise tax, 4.9 billion a month we will be losing from the excise income. So times 3 months, that will be to the tune of around 14 to 15 billion. So that will be a problem. It will be a gain
Although, to be
for
fair, the DOE, just for comparison, quotes 9.8 billion. So, okay lang, sir. But just a, ano,
right.
important for our viewers to know that the
Exactly. Well,
figures vary.
yung count kasi ng DOE, Ms. Karen, could be like around starting October and November kasi
Oo, pwede.
expected na nabababa itong oil price by December, according to Congressman Joey Salceda, the chairman of the Ways and Means Committee. According to his research, bababa ito by December. So, maaaring yung computation nila, pero kami kasi nila, Kong Fernandez was computing itong September, October, and November. Kasi December, definitely bababa. Plus, the oil companies are asking to ease up on this bioethanol act na if they will be allowed to use imported bioethanol kasi it's more cheaper than getting it from overseas. So
So you
10
have to
pesos the
review.
excise plus 4 pesos the bioethanol, that's about 14 pesos per liter.
So for that to happen, will Congress need to repeal the law or a president giving an executive order? I'm not sure with the process because the Bioethanol Act is an existing law. For them to start importing, what needs to be done?
It should be a yun nga lang yung pag sa excise they were saying na we need to pass a law in order to suspend the excise pero this was done daw in 2020 yung when the government suspended the VAT the value added tax for several weeks so the president can also do this pero he has to consult siguro with the economic managers. The real impact after yung effect nito by next year if we lose these excise taxes.
Okay. Now, what does the economic team recommend? I mean, the economic team is now under fire. Also, when it comes to the price of rice, you have several groups asking for the resignation of Finance Secretary Ben Diokno and even NEDA Chair Balisakan. We know that if we can't control the price of fuel, you have the price of rice, basic commodities, vegetables, inflation, this affects GDP growth. Kumbaga, it's a domino effect, right?
That's what we are addressing right now, Ms. Karen. The speaker in constant communication with the president and his economic managers. They're always in a huddle, I believe, every night. They're talking regarding this matter, comparing figures. Tama ka, the economic managers, ang suggestion nila to give ayuda. And that was also brought up yesterday during our initial meeting with the House leadership before we met with the oil companies. Siguro mas magandang ayuda, pero there were also questions like, teka muna kung ayuda, di ilang percent lang mabibigyan. Baka matulad tayo nung panahon ng pandemic na hindi nabigyan lahat.
It's one pocket to another. Magbigay ka ng ayuda, galing rin naman yun sa taong bayan. Yung ayuda pinamimigay mo.
Or hindi lahat mabibigyan. May magiging kasi si chairman, yung kamag-anak niyang inuna. So we're back to square one again, yung parang panahon ng pandemic na hindi lahat nakatikim ng ayuda. Kaya nga, siguro yung solution really, we have to put our heads together. What is the best way para everybody will benefit? Hindi lang yung mga mahihirap, hindi lang yung mga masasakyan, kundi pati yung middle class, everybody will benefit dito sa gagawin ng gobyerno, itong dialogue nga with the oil companies. What do we have to do?
Okay, is it possible, I'm just curious, to be selective about suspending the excise tax on fuel? Let's say for it's a certain period of time, let's say for 3 months, it's all public buses, all jeepneys, all taxis, all tricycles, kumbaga, all public transportation, hands down. It's an order from the president that this is their price. But all private vehicles, it's the same price. I don't know if that's been on the table.
Na kay Presidente, somebody already discussed that, gave that opinion yesterday. Kung po pwede raw excise, aalisin para sa mga mahirap, yung mga public transport and middle class. Pero pag luxury yung sasakyan mo, mga B8, B6, and then dapat hindi na exempted sa excise tax, yun ang sinasabi nila. Kasi yung talagang tinatamaan dito yung middle class hanggang yun sa mga commuter, that is the effect. Pero syempre, all of these will have to be discussed by the economic team, by the president and Congress, syempre, and the Senate. To what to do. We need this ASAP, Ms. Karen.
Yeah. Kasi tama ka. The problem you have is time. We're hitting October soon.
Exactly. Pero yung sa rice price cap, Ms. Karen, good news is there were already recommendations from CNAG and the Farmers Group to baka pwedeng kansilahin. And what I have been hearing from Malacanang, the president may suspend it hopefully by the end of the month or around October. Pag pumasok na ito mga newly harvested na palay, siyempre, bababa na yan because we have enough or ample of supply of rice. So, bababa na itong presyo. So, aalisin na yung rice price cap. Then. And yun naman talaga ang objective of Malacanang. Lagyan ng price cap lang ngayon habang taghirap ng bigas. Pero ang talaga ang target nila towards the end of the month or around first or second week of October, aalisin na yung rice price cap na yan, Ms. Karen.
Okay. Now, moving on to rice a bit, will there be a redefinition of the NFA? The reason I'm asking is the primary responsibility of the NFA today is just to buffer stock, right? And the president announced a different pricing scheme for the NFA when it purchases rice. Nung panahon natin, Congressman Irwin, as when you were a reporter, we remember that the NFA was also selling rice. I mean, of course, there were corruption issues with the NFA because it was importing rice as well. But you would see rice noon that was 27 pesos in the market, right? Different quality, but then still you'd have rice that it was subsidized, I remember, by 7 pesos. So yung 26, 7 pesos ang subsidy ng gobyerno doon. Is there a recommendation from the speaker how we can maximize what to do with the NFA?
yung we have to review the rice liberalization or rice tariffication law kasi nakapaloob yun doon para to allow if we have to junk this rice tariffication law or rice liberalization law, if we have to junk it, then we have to replace with something, then we will give power. Pinag-uusapan na, Ms. Karen, is on the table with the Committee on Agriculture headed by Congressman Enverga and the Speaker and other House leadership kung ano ang gagawin to giving back the power of NFA to purchase palay, and then the NFA will sell the rice, mill it, and sell it to the public para we can control. I believe we're heading towards that direction, yeah. Karen.
Because the problem of the NFA before, and you remember this, Congressman Tulfo, was the head was corrupt. There was systemic corruption issues in the NFA. But if you change the system and the head, right, if you had like a Lacson on NFA or whoever that was anti-corruption, then it could maybe function better.
It was also discussed, Ms. Karen, if we have to go back to the old ways, the NFA will purchase palay directly to the farmers or from the farmers, then we have to put somebody there na capable and medyo diretso ang tingin, hindi kung saan-saan, at saka hindi corrupt. I believe we can really fix this problem, Ms. Karen. Talaga kailangan lang natin, for now, if you would ask me, not only me, but even the Makaya Bayan Bloc and other fellow congressmen there, it's really high time now. We really have to review this oil, this rice tariffication law or rice liberalization law, Ms. Karen.
Okay. All right. Now, another issue here is the Makabayan Bloc. Let's go back now to the issue of oil. The Makabayan Bloc blames actually the government on something simple. Budget mismanagement, the president's foreign trips, the confidential funds for certain agencies, instead of spending it for the right things.
Okay. And the question
is, that being one of them, possibly, right?
Well, my point naman, Ms. Karen, I mean, the Makabayan Bloc has a point, and trabaho naman talaga nila yon to always check, parang may checks and balances. We do embrace that. Tama naman yung ginagawa ng Makabayan Bloc to really check. Meron tayong ikang bastonero or something. Pero I believe kami sa majority, we really have to study further these issues kasi medyo critical siya eh. At saka ang daming mga issue na dapat uusapan, dapat ayusin kung maiimbestigan naman tayo sa mga confidential intelligence funds, yung mga expenses of travel by the president. Why don't we just focus on something like come up like ginagawa po natin yesterday, talking to oil price or oil companies, talking next week may plano si speaker na kausapin yung mga food manufacturers, canned goods, supermarkets kung pwedeng i-hold off muna because they are asking DTI now, this group of business people, na tataas din sila. Pero unfortunately, it's almost Christmas season, Ms. Karen. E pag tinaasan mo yung mga canned goods, what is going to happen? I mean, we will have a very bleak Christmas, Ms. Karen. So ito yung dapat unahin ng siguro ng Kongreso, ng Senado. How can we address the problem of the people? Pag kumakalam kasi ang sikmura, Ms. Karen, hindi ka nakakaisip ng tama. So we have to address this muna, these issues, rather than investigating itong budget papunta roon, saan ang nanggaling, di ba? It's more helpful if we find solution to the current problem, Ms. Karen.
Yeah. So just to be specific, since the numbers were given out what it would cost the government if excise tax was removed and if they can import bioethanol. I'm curious, do you have a calculation of just how much private companies can cut? What sacrifice can they make? Is there already a number with that? I mean, do you already have the number on the profit per liter of oil companies?
Doon sa usapan lang namin sa Congress, kami yung mga House leadership na pag-usapan, kaya nila hanggang 5 pesos, Ms. Karen. Eh. 5
really?
To 10, 10 talagang
really?
Sacrifice. Yes.
Kaya that's nila 5 pesos na wala pa tong government intervention.
That's what we were just waiting, Ms. Karen. But we, of course, we cannot dictate it because of this all the regulation law. Pero we were looking, according to our economic managers then, sila Congressman Salceda, sila Congresswoman Kiambao, kakayanin eh, sila Congressman Saldico, kakayanin eh, hanggang 5 pesos eh. They, at saka yung downgradation na sinasabi, you import early kasi when you import for December, you import now or you ask them now, place your order now, mababang-mababa, Ms. Karen, why don't they do that? Bakit hindi na sila way ahead mag-order na for December para lalong bumaba? Kasi parang bumababa ng something like about $10 per barrel pag, pag nag-import ka very early on.
Oh, but then clearly there's a bigger issue here in terms of the country's future, right? We are an importing country when it comes to oil. You have factors that are outside. So, for example, in the report, there were production curbs set by Russia and Saudi Arabia. You have forex issues, world prices issues. There has to be a systemic change.
Yeah, I believe so, Ms. Karen.
And what do we do?
It should be a constant study and meeting by the economic managers, by several groups, Congress, Senate, the executive, to come up with a plan or better idea, clearer idea on what do we have to do. Kasi ito mga solutions right now that we're coming up, these are band-aid solutions. We want a long-term solution for everybody, Ms. Karen. Yeah. So we really need to put our heads together para to come up with something. Siguro all the stakeholders, hindi lang government, kundi pati yung mga private sector, motorists, oil companies, yung mga consumers, we really have parang a dialogue of what do we have to do? Because, Ms. Karen, if you really look at it, parang itong country natin, we're living under one roof, okay? We're having a hard time. I mean, the padre de familia is having a hard time to feed the family because of these blah, 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 budget cuts or whatever, high prices. So we really have to get the inputs of everybody, Ms. Karen. I believe okay. That's what we should do.
All right. Just two more questions for you. That's quite interesting. It's up to you how you want to answer it. There are talks that you might be the running mate of Speaker Martin Romualdez if he chooses to run for president. You're the VP. Is that true? Is it on the table?
No, not at all. Not at all, Ms. Karen. I'm just helping. I am a deputy majority leader for communications. That's why I am talking to you. That's why I entertain when the media would call somebody. Mr. Speaker designated me to be the spokesperson of Congress. So
no VP plans for you?
No, Ms. Karen. That's very, very way, way off, Ms. Karen. Way off.
No. All right. Okay. My last question is, the speaker won't answer this, but there's talk of a $2 million donation to Harvard University. I mean, I don't know if you're allowed to speak on that, but why won't he answer it if it's a donation to push? Actually, it pushed the Filipino language globally. It's something that he could actually be proud of and speak of. Why won't he answer these questions?
True enough, Ms. Karen. It's a personal, that's from his own pocket. And marami, lalo mga Tigalete, alam naman talaga na mayayaman ng mga Romualdez. They can afford that. Pero yung not answering it, Ms. Karen, because I already asked the speaker yesterday morning about it. I said, like, Mr. Speaker, marami po nagtatanong. He said, like, instead na mag-focus tayo dyan, Kong Erwin, why don't we just focus, look for a solution dito sa problema ng sambayanan? Okay, sasagutin ko nga yan, pero ma-address ba natin yung problem ng bayan ngayon? Pero kung ako ang tatanungin mo, Ms. Karen, kung milyonaryo ka man, 2 million dollars is about 100 million pesos, eh, kung yun, you know, personal naman niya talaga, eh, pera naman ta, pera niya, and I believe it is, so... I mean, why not? Diba? Marami siya mga kaibigan doon, mga ika nga sa Congress. Marami ako nakikita ng mga kaklase niya dati na nag-masteral sa Harvard. So medyo malapit din sa kanya sa puso yung Harvard na ito. Pero yun na, kaya hindi niya sinasagot, Ms. Karen, because mas maraming problema na dapat isikasuhin daw na we have to waste, ika nga, devote time on how to solve this problem itong oil prices, food prices, ito yung mga dapat unahin, Ms. Karen.
Okay, so my last question, back to the oil price, do you have a timetable? I mean, clearly there's pressure here. It's a crisis situation. Meron ba itong sa isang linggo, dalawang linggo, dapat, Karen, eto sabi ni Speaker, bababa ang presyo ng langis. May gano'n na ba kayong napag-usapan, sir?
We are waiting for the response from the oil companies, yung kanilang mga principals, mga chairman of the board nila. Because they were asking, yung mga managers yesterday were asking like, give us about a week, Mr. Speaker, we'll come back. So we will be meeting them again. So we're expecting like around probably, hopefully end of September, Ms. Karen, we have a result already, or at least the very latest will be like around first week or second week of October, we can do something about it. Because we also have to lay down to the president and at the options, Ms. Karen, the plans of our Congress, suggestions.
All right. Okay. Well, well said. Thank you so much. So most likely first week of October, definitely there's some change, right? There's action. Okay. On that note, I want to thank you, Congressman Erwin Tulfo, for joining me today. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am, for the time again. You have a wonderful day.